Welcome, dear students, to EPG Parshala. I am Dr. K.S. Nagaraja of Deccan College, Pune, teaching the course of Historical Linguistics. In this module, we look at one type of change which is quite common, but which is unlike the sound change, is quite different from sound change, is called analogical change. Interestingly, the neo-grammarians made a distinction between sound change and analogical change. Sound change is something which is systematic, which is exceptionless, which is unobservable, whereas analogical change is all which is not analogical change. So they try to put it as more like a waste basket. What is not explainable under sound change should belong to analogical change. So analogical change is a very important, plays an important role for neo-grammarians, for that matter. And also, it's quite important for language as such, because a lot of changes can be accounted for by analogical change. So in this module, we look at the various types of analogical changes possible in human languages. Sound change, borrowing, and analogy have traditionally been considered the three most important or basic types of linguistic change. In spite of the importance of analogy, linguistics textbooks seem to struggle when it comes to the definition of analogy. Scholar Arletto, recognizing the problem of offering an adequate definition, gives what he calls a purposely vague and general definition. Analogy is a process whereby one form of a language becomes more like another with which it is somehow associated. So though the Arletto's definition is somewhat vague and inadequate, it shows that the analogical change involves a relation of similarity. It emphasizes on the fact that it involves a relation of similarity. That's a very important one. The definition is vague because there are many different degrees to which forms can become more alike, and there are various types of associations which might motivate the changes involved. But one generalization about analogical creation is important to note at the beginning itself. Its effect is the disappearance of irregular or anomalous forms. There is one very important restriction on analogy. The working of analogy does not create any new forms or categories in a language. Analogy only causes the spread or extension of already existing form. Analogy is not a change like sound change. It is a leveling process only. Many changes in a language cannot be explained by rigidly operating sound laws. That is, laws which operate only with regard to phonetic factors. Certain other important types of changes have been grouped under the heading of analogy. Analogy is a function of the relational aspects of grammar and a mental striving for simplicity or uniformity. For the neo-grammarians, sound change was considered regular, borrowing need to be identified, and analogy was, in effect, everything else that was left over. That is, almost everything that was not sound change or borrowing was analogy. Analogy became the default or wastebasket category of changes. In analogical change, one piece of the language changes to become more like another pattern in the language. Analogy is sometimes described as internal borrowing. The idea being that in analogical change, a language may borrow from some of its own patterns to change other patterns. So, let us consider an example of analogy. Originally, sorry and sorrow were quite distinct. But in its history, sorry has changed under influence from sorrow to become more similar to sorrow. Sorry is from the adjective form of sore, Old English sarig, sore, pained, sensitive, that is derived from the Old English noun sar, sore, which has cognates in other Germanic languages. The original A of sarig changed to O and then was shortened to O under influence from sorrow. Old English sor, grief, deep sadness or regret, which had no historical connection to sorry. This is an analogical change where the form of sorry changed on analogy with that of sorrow. The term analogy is used in many senses, all having to do with some kind of regularity. Mainly, analogy involves meaning, that is forms, and sound change involves form only. Analogy is predominantly conditioned by morphology and other areas of grammar. That is why it is also called by name as grammar-oriented change. A grammar is largely a system of relations. An analogy is a system of similarity. Traditionally, two major kinds of analogical changes have been distinguished, proportional and non-proportional, although the distinction is not always clear or relevant. And the other major distinction is analogical leveling and analogical extension. Proportional analogical changes are those which can be represented in an equation of the form two-part versus four-part analogy. A to B is equals to C to X, where one solves X, that is A is to B as C is to what. The X will answer that what. For example, ride, road, dive, what will be the fourth one, where in this instance X is solved with do. In this analogical change, the original past of dive was dived, but it changed to do under analogy with the class of verbs which behave like drive, drove, ride, rode, write, wrote, strive, strove, and so on. The fourth term analogy of the form A to B is as C to X is also sometimes presented in another form. For example, as A to B is same as C to X, etc. So stone, stones, hand, the fourth column to be filled. Similarly, pen, pens, book, books, the fourth slot gets filled by the productive form like hands, books, instead of handa and beach, respectively, of Middle English. Similarly, we can have a proportion like cactus, cacti, octopus. Greek plural was octopedes. Japan, Japanese, official, officialese comes into being. Land, landscape, sea, seascape. So two pot analogies are possible: moon, moonscape, citizen, denizen, etc. So a famous example comes from Otto Espersen's observation of a Danish child who was corrected for saying knock instead of nickede, that is nodded, and immediately retorted sticker stock, knicker knock, thus showing on what analogies he had formed the new preterite. That is, the child produced the proportional formula sticker sticks, stoke, that is stuck, is knicker, nods, knack, nodded. In English, the pattern of the verb speak, spoke, spoken, that is present tense, past participle, developed through remodeling on analogy with verbs of the pattern break, broke, broken. In Old English, it was spread, sprout, gesprechen, compare spoke, past tense of early modern English with present day spoke. Analogical leveling reduces the number of allomorphs a form has. It makes paradigms more uniform. In analogical leveling, forms which formerly underwent alternations no longer do so after the change. For instance, some English strong verbs have been leveled to the weak verb pattern, as for instance in dialects where throw, threw, thrown has become throw, throwed, throwed. So the strong verb structure has been weakened. So instead of three-part contrast, we have two-part contrast. Second, there are numerous cases throughout the history of English in which strong verbs with stem alternations, as in sing, sang, sung, or write, wrote, written, have been leveled to weak verbs with a single stem form and ed or is equivalent for past and past participle, as in woke, boked, boked, or live, lived, lived. In English, the former comparative and superlative forms of old have been leveled from the pattern old, elder, eldest to the non-alternating pattern old, older, oldest. Here, O has been fronted by umlaut due to the formal presence of front vowels in the second syllable of elder and eldest, but the effects of umlaut were leveled out, and now the words elder and eldest remain only in restricted context, not as the regular comparative and superlative of old. A case of leveling involving French is given here in this particular data. Is compared with, we have three stage comparison: Latin, Old French, and Modern French. So, singular, plural. Similarly, we have another instance from Sanskrit, comparing with Sanskrit, pre-Pali and Pali. So, here also we have singular, plural, contrast, first person, second person, third person. Sanskrit inherited from Proto-Indo-European a morphophonemic alternation between a full grade form us and a zero grade form sir. Pali continues this alternation in the third person forms, but in the first and second persons, the full grade form us has become generalized through leveling. So now we move to analogical extension, though in a way it is somewhat rarer compared to the earlier one, analogical leveling. It extends the already existing alternation of some pattern to new forms which did not formally undergo the alternation. An example of analogical extension is seen in the case mentioned above of diode being replaced by do on analogy with the strong verb pattern, as in drive drove, ride road, and so on, an extension of the alternating pattern of the strong verbs. Another instance where a form or an alternation is carried into a new environment, we have extension. For example, the morphemes ism and able were borrowed into English as parts of hundreds of loan words, humanism, usable, etc. These endings have been extended to native stems or roots as well, tokenism, thinkable, etc. Analogy in stems also possible. The clearest examples of analogy occur in the disappearance of stem alternation within a given paradigm. A paradigm is a set of different forms which a word may assume to indicate different functions or meanings within a particular sentence. So, declensions of nouns are the conjugations of verbs or paradigms. In simple analogy in stems, one phoneme will replace another in a form in order to make it more like other forms in the same paradigm. So, analogy in affixes, which is much more common. So, here we have Old English singular plural and New English singular plural. As already indicated earlier, hand, handa, which has changed in New English to hands, gear had a zero plural suffix, it has become ears, eyes, stones, all of them had different forms in Old English. So in New English, there is the affixes have become common or general. Still, of course, a few irregular forms continue in the language, like sheep, sheep, ox, oxen, child, children, man, men, woman, women, etc. The relationship between analogy and sound change. The fundamental conflict between sound change and analogy was neatly summed up by a dictum often called Sutherland's paradox. Sound change is regular but produces irregularity. Analogy is irregular but produces regularity. That is, regular sound change can create alternations or variant allomorphs. For example, umlaut was a regular sound change in which back vowels were fronted due to the presence of a front vowel in a later syllable, as in brother plus n, brethren. As a result of this regular sound change, the root for brother came to have two variants, brother and brethr. Earlier English had many alternations of this sort. However, an irregular analogical change later created brothers as the plural form on analogy with the non-alternating singular plural pattern in such nouns as sister, sisters. This analogical change is irregular in that it applied only now and then, here and there, to individual alternating forms, not across the board to all such alternations at the same time. The analogical change in the case of brethren, in effect, resulted in undoing the irregularity created by the sound change, leaving only a single form, brother, as the root in both the singular and plural forms. That is, analogy level out the alternation left behind by the sound change. Brethren survives only in a restricted context with specialized meaning. An interesting but somewhat complicated example is the following. Here, Latin rhoticism and the interaction of analogy with sound change can be seen. The partial paradigm of nouns honor, honor, arbor, tree, melior, better are given below. So, stage 1, Latin before 400 BC, we can posit the following paradigm in the pre-Latin period, where it is very regular. In the second stage, the sound, the rhoticism takes place, wherein sa changes to r between vowels. So by that we get an alternation here. So irregular sa r alternation comes into being. In fact, Grimm noticed for Latin this kind of situation, but much later. Stage 3, after 200 BC, analogical reformation of nominative singular takes place. Even this stage is regular. You say the reformation brings in regularity with the suffixes. So in the above examples, the regular sound change in stage 2 rhoticism created allomorphy, that is irregularity in the paradigm. Later, irregular analogy changed honors and melios, that is nominative singular forms, to honor and melior, both now ending in r, matching the r of the rest of the forms in this paradigm. Thus, irregular analogy has regularized the form of the root, eliminating the allomorphic alternations involving the final consonant of the root. Next, we move on to another issue here. When analogy takes place, what is the model for it? Here we consider two types of situations. We consider the distinction between immediate models and non-immediate models. These have to do with the place in the language where we find the relation of similarity which is behind the analogical change. Cases involving non-immediate models are like those of the Latin lobos, labor, changing to labor. Due to the influence of whole classes of words or paradigms which do not normally occur in discourse in the near vicinity of the form that changes. So, as opposed to that, an immediate model refers to a situation in which the relation of similarity upon which the analogical change is based is found in the same speech context as the thing that changes. This refers to instances where the thing that changes and the thing that influences it to change are immediately juxtaposed to one another or are located very near to each other in frequently repeated pieces of speech. Thus, analogical changes based on an immediate model are typically found in frequently recited routines, such as sequences of basic numbers, days of the week, months of the year, or in phrases used so frequently they can almost be taken as a unit. For example, month names are frequently used together in sequence. As a result, for many English speakers, because of the immediate model of January, February has changed to February, becoming more like January. And many examples can be quoted for this type. Male, female versus male, female. For instance, is of the same type, where female was earlier female. However, in the immediate model of male and female, frequently uttered together, the earlier female, the modern, the Middle English form, changed to be more similar to male, so it became female. So we have many examples of this type, but we move on to the next one. Other kinds of analogy. One is hypercorrection. Hypercorrection is a process involving overdoing something which should not have been done just because a particular pattern is there. For instance, in Kannada, there is a clear distinction between presence and absence of ha in the initial position. Halu is milk, Halli is village, but the contrast is Alli is there without ha, etc. But those who do not know the distinction, if they extend ha to where ha should not have been there, we see a case of hypercorrection. It is due to case of analogy. The second type is folk etymology, also known as popular etymology. This is characterized by the reinterpretation of words whose surface morphology has become synchronically opaque by means of words or morphemes that are more familiar. Is a very good example is from English hamburger. In fact, it is actually German. German Hamburg plus a person who is from Hamburg, a city. So similarly, we can think of Berliner, Wiener, etc. While hamburgers are not made of ham, speakers have folk etymologized hamburger as having something to do with ham, and English reanalysis gave rise to ham plus burger. So we have now burger, cheeseburger, chili burger, veg burger, etc. So this is folk etymology, nothing else. Third one is back formation. In back formation, it's also known as retrograde formation, a type of folk formation. A word is assumed to have a morphological composition which it did not originally have, usually a root plus affixes, so that when the affixes are removed, a new modified root is created. In fact, we have a case like in English cheese, when it was taken into the language, when they observed that there is something s in the end, they thought that that should be the plural suffix, so they took it out and they created a new noun, singular root, chi. So this is because of the fact that the sa is a plural suffix in the language. Of course, children often do this kind of obtain this kind of formations. We can get in English lots of instances of this type are found. Then we move on to another type, what is known as meta-analysis or reanalysis. Is from Greek meta, change, analysis. And as the name suggests, reanalysis or meta-analysis involves a change in the structural analysis, in the interpretation of which phonological material goes with which morpheme in a word or construction. In this, a word which historically has one particular morphological structure comes to be perceived by speakers as having a second, quite different structure. For instance, a good example is bikini. Bikini was originally a single morpheme, but it was reanalyzed by someone as having a structure along the lines of B plus kini, B is by 2. So swimming costume, skinny means swimming costume. As a result, the prefix B would be replaced by a different prefix, mono, that is one, to derive the new word monokini, bikini with no top. Cases of unicorn and others can be listed here. Then the next type is contamination. As already indicated, it is a reshaping of a word on the basis of constant association with some other word. It occurs when two ideas or constructions come up in the mind of the speaker simultaneously or following each other so closely that the two get fused into one each containing the parts of both. Contamination is similar to blending in that it results from the interaction between semantically closely related forms. So we may have a construction like short-sleeved shirts made of sea sucker changes to short-sleeved shirts made of sheer sucker. Here the sound, the rhyming sound because of the contamination. As we said, blending, which is in a way a sort of contamination. Pieces of two or more different words are combined to create new words. Usually the words which contribute the pieces that go into the makeup of the new word are semantically related in some way, sometimes as synonyms for things which have the same or very similar meaning. Often cited examples include smog. Smog is smoke plus fog. Tigran, tiger plus lion. Brunch, breakfast plus lunch. Cameleopard, camel plus leopard. Motel, mobile plus hotel, etc. are some examples. In fact, we can think of many more. Marathon. With marathon, we have telethon, walkathon, etc. Watergate, Contragate, Coregate, Irongate, etc. You can see one pattern allows to obtain other things of the same type. But a very interesting case is Zulu and Nubian. Zulu and Nubian were two British cruisers. They both got damaged during the World War I. The undamaged halves of the two were taken out and put together, and a new vessel was created and they called it as Zubian. So Zulu plus Nubian becomes Zubian. Contamination occurs frequently in antonyms, pairs of words with related but opposite meanings. It is also commonly encountered in numerals. So, analogy in word order, spread of a particular syntactic construction is possible. Normally, it's case of simplification. In English, the old English had adjective plus noun plus adjective, good man and clean and very noble, or good and clean and very noble man. In New English, only one type is allowed, adjective plus noun, good man, decent man, cheerful man, or good, decent, cheerful man. So always the head noun comes at the right end and all the adjectives come before it. A second example, in Old English, the word order was yes, we wo in only main clauses, but in subordinate clauses, it was yes, wo we. However, now the word order is only one type, that is the word order is yes, we wo. The main characteristic of these analogical changes is that they are conditioned by non-phonological factors. They either increase or reduce the scope of morphophonemic alternations that have been introduced by earlier sound changes. Thus, the basis of analogical change of sounds is a grammatical paradigm in which one or more morphophonemic alternations occur. We may consider these changes of sounds as having the following three types of effects upon alternations. They may reduce the number of alternations by extending one of them at the expense of the rest. Two, they may extend the scope of an alternation by bringing in non-alternating forms into its scope. Three, they may remove an alternation by converting all alternating items into non-alternating ones. These analogical changes are actually changes of grammatical paradigms. They are motivated by the necessity to simplify the paradigms by reducing the complexity that has been introduced into them by earlier sound changes. Notice that all the three types of changes mentioned above affect alternations in such a way that they ultimately simplify the paradigms in which the alternations occur. So that is the nature of analogy and analogical change. To summarize then, we have looked at various types of analogical changes possible in human languages. Obviously, the basic types are either analogical leveling or analogical extension. And they can also go beyond these two in under various types called back formation and others. In fact, there are very, in this particular module, we have studied many different types of analogy, regular, irregular. And this particular aspect has great relevance for further study, because we'll be looking at other types of change also, like grammatical change and lexical change, etc. So this particular type has a role there also as well. Students may keep note of this particular aspect so that it will be useful there as well. So the analogical change as is quite significant. In fact, all books, basic books on historical linguistics discuss this particular aspect. In fact, there are attempts to formalize this future all as well. So students could study the books available, given in the references, and also through internet, so that they can gain more knowledge on this issue.